is exciting sport in what amounts to a mountainside arena. Cross country and the biathlon, on the other hand, are very different. They're an almost mystical world of silence and beauty and the constant battle against exhaustion. Jack Whitaker has been living in the world of the cross-country skier and the biathlete, well, ever since these games began. He has the 10-kilometer biathlon for us now.
Often been a clamorous intruder to the snowy silence of the forest. But these athletes are not out to disturb the tranquility of nature's winter paradise. They are biathletes, a rare breed that combine the exhilaration and grueling physical demands of cross-country skiing with the poise and concentration that's required to be a top marksman, a poise that must come quickly to the athlete after his all-out exertion on the ski trail. Two different sports. One needs wind and fire. The other needs steel and ice. These are the biathlon shooting coaches whose job it is to make expert shooters out of expert skiers. Both skills must be mastered. One of the world's best biathletes is Peter Unger of West Germany, who won the gold medal in the 20-kilometer biathlon last Saturday. And today he was off to a good start. Some biathletes are not in Peter's class, and you can no longer be competitive in this sport just by being a good skier or just by being a good shot. You must combine both. This is Willie Caro of the United States. America has not been successful in international competition for several reasons. There are 60,000 biathletes in the Soviet Union, 200 in the United States. Since biathlon skills began in the Army, Americans still think of it as a military exercise, though there is nothing of the military about it. And finally, there is a lack of money. $100,000 was the complete budget for this Olympic year. We asked Willie how he thought the U.S. would do here.
Well, that's a hard thing to say. We all are going for our best personal performances, and but I think the level that we're at right now, we probably, none of us, I don't think, are going to expect any medals, but I think maybe a top 20 finish would be an excellent performance.
A top 20 finish would be a remarkable achievement for America's biathlon team, for they are the orphans of the American Olympic movement. Cinderella's sitting by the fire while the Alpine and Nordic skiers go to the ball. There is no question that biathlon skills did begin in the military, and it was in the years preceding World War II that those skills became known. The world at large realized the value of skis in war during the winter of 1939 in the war between the Russians and the Finns. The Finns, taking advantage of the mobility of skis, were able to bring the Russian army to a complete halt using hit-and-run raids on vulnerable supply and communication lines. In World War II, both the Allied and Axis armies maintained mountain troops. The Germans and the Italians were among those with mountain guards, and there was a special esprit de corps among them.
Oh,
A little known fact is that the United States Army also maintained a mountain division, the 10th. They trained in Colorado. Their motto was, "We conquer mountains and men." And conquer they did. In fact, they were one of the most amazing outfits ever to fight for our country. The 10th helped to regain the Aleutian island of Kiska from the Japanese. And then towards the end of the war, in a dawn attack, the 10th Division captured and defended the key position of Mount Belvedere in the Alps, opening the way to Austria for Allied troops. America's interest in ski warfare has been dramatically revived. The Marines have trained over 15,000 troops for winter weather, and the Army is training over 300 a year in cold weather tactics. One of the ironies of these winter games is that the venue for the biathlon is on Igman Mountain, the site of a World War II action involving the Yugoslav partisans against the Germans. On January 27, 1942, the partisans began what is known as the Igman March. For 18 hours, in bitterly cold weather, the Yugoslavs climbed the mountain. 160 men froze to death. Today, a monument honors their memory, and the hope is that forevermore, Igman Mountain will be a place of recreation and peace. Even in springtime, there are footprints in the snow. There are the sounds of soldiers shuffling. There are screams of terror, frozen in time. Forever echoes of a war won too late. A cold stone monument with a heart of heroes, bleeding a halo of wild purple flowers, softly singing a song of purpose and futility. In time, snow will return to this field. There will be crowds from many countries. There will be cries of victory for another partisan cause. These soldiers will wage a war of symbols, and some will win medals. But now, each will pass the monument in pursuit of peace, hoping to leave new footprints in the Sarajevo snow.